is making a last-ditch effort to avoid being blacklisted by the Financial Action Task Force, or the FATF, the Global Terror Financing Watchdog. A joint session of Pakistan's parliament has been convened to pass two bills that are part of Islamabad's commitment to the FATF. The bills relate to terror financing and money laundering specifically. This session comes ahead of the Terror Financing Watchdog's meeting, which will start from Tuesday. The body is set to decide whether or not it will blacklist Pakistan. The country is already on the grey list. Earlier, the Pakistan government held a meeting to get all the opposition parties on board for proposed legislations related to the FATF. The government said that the bills are necessary for getting the country out of the FATF grey list. Some of the biggest perpetrators of terror continue to remain beyond the reach of law in Pakistan. Take Masood Azhar, for example. He has been named by India's investigative agencies in the Pulwama attack, but Pakistan claims to have no idea about his whereabouts. Islamabad says Azhar is quote-unquote missing, but multiple reports indicate that Pakistan intelligence agencies are very well aware of Azhar's whereabouts and continue to shield him. So far, Pakistan has been saved by its friends like China, Turkey and Malaysia from further action at the FATF, but at some point that safety shield will also expire. Firstly, instead of clamping down on terrorists, Pakistan is misusing the laws to suppress critical voices, with the arrest of journalists, violence threats against editors even. Secondly, Pakistan government is trying to play politics. It has been trying to convince the opposition to back these two bills on FATF-related matters. What are these bills? The second amendment to the Anti-Money Laundering Bill and the Islamabad Capital Territory Waqf Properties Bill. Both of these are related to curbing money laundering and terror financing. Pakistan can then claim to show progress when it comes to curbing terror. Thirdly, Imran Khan is still busy saving Bajwa, who is finding himself in the midst of a corruption scandal. The Pakistan Prime Minister likes to paint himself as a leader, a crusader when it comes to anti-corruption. He continues to, at the same time, shield corrupt officials. He doesn't talk about them. His government goes after anyone who does. The FATF's list of demands is absolutely clear. Earlier this year, Pakistan was evaluated on 27 parameters. It failed on 13 action points. There were four broad parameters on which Pakistan did not comply. One was anti-money laundering and terror financing. Two, prosecution and penalizing terror financing. Third, transparency and secrecy in financial institutions operations. And four, implementing an effective national mechanism to check illegal funding of terror outfits. Pakistan failed on all four counts. So the immediate question that arises is, how long can Imran Khan try and save the country? And our Pakistan Bureau Chief Anas Malik is joining us live on the broadcast from Islamabad. Tell us more about the kind of measures that Pakistan is trying to make in its last-ditch attempt to save itself from being blacklisted by the Financial Action Task Force.
The Imran Khan government faces a major roadblock ahead of the crucial face-to-face meeting of the joint working group of the Asia-Pacific group with regards to the Financial Action Task Force, that the body that has been designated by the Financial Action Task Force to overlook. Now, these two legislation, these two bills, they have been already approved by the Pakistani parliament, but they were rejected by the Pakistani Senate, that is the upper house of the Pakistani parliament. The National Assembly had approved because the PTI government has a majority in the National Assembly, but it does not in the Senate. Now, the government is deliberating on bringing these bills through, in getting them passed through a joint sitting of the parliament, which is likely to be called on Tuesday. And with regards to that, a motion is to be moved as well in the parliamentary session. Now, if you talk about these bills particularly, what does it mean? It would give Pakistan an edge because Pakistan, with regards to the to the compliance of the 27th action plan, the pointer action plan. The Pakistani side has to do some amendments in its laws with regards to that and has to comply with some international standards. That includes bringing in the non-regulated informal economy into a more channelized manner, and that is what this bill is about. The second amendment of the Waqf for Properties Bill and the Anti-Money Laundering Bill, it focuses on the unregulated economy, especially those of that of state agents, jewelers, lawyers, and so on and so forth. People from these walks of life, that those who are by and large an unregulated economy, they should be regulated and brought into the ambit. And that in case if they're involved, then they should be punished in a more harder and effective manner. That is what the bill has suggested. So the government aims at getting it through through a joint sitting of the Pakistani Parliament. That is likely to happen on the 15th or on the 16th of September.
All right, so all eyes on that crucial FATF meeting. Also joining us in the broadcast is our principal diplomatic correspondent in New Delhi, Siddhant Sibal. Siddhant, let's also speak about the impact that a possible blacklisting of Pakistan by the FATF will have for Pakistan's economy. The country's prime minister himself has admitted that blacklisting will destroy the Pakistani economy.
Well, yes, Molly, just a few days ago, there was an interview of the Pakistani Prime Minister on the occasion of the anniversary of the PTI government, the ruling PTI government in Pakistan. A question was asked and he said that it will devastate the Pakistani economy. It will increase the inflation, and this high inflation will be impacting and pinching the people on the ground. By and large, he blamed the Indian government, saying that India has been pushing Pakistan on the blacklist. Already, we know the Pakistani government has publicly accepted that being on the grey list, it has been on the grey list for the last 2 years. It is making a loss of almost $10 billion. What basically impacts is that if you're on the grey list or perhaps in the blacklist, it is a warning to potential investors not to invest in the country because your money might be used for terror financing in the country. So by and large, for that, we know domestically the Pakistani government has been saying it has been doing a lot of things. In fact, the parliamentary session, the joint parliamentary session which Anas was talking about, is coinciding with the APG, or the Asia Pacific Joint Working Group, or meeting of the FATF, which will happen tomorrow and day after tomorrow. It will of course happen virtually, and there is an alliance of countries now which of course includes India and like-minded countries which have been demanding Pakistan to implement things on the ground. And clearly they are not buying what Pakistan is selling when it comes to the issue of terrorism. They are saying that Pakistan needs to do more, and that is something that will be finally tested, or the litmus test will be done in October when the FATF's main body meets in Paris. So basically, right now the big focus is on the Paris meeting of the FATF. But by and large, Pakistani government, as it has been domestically saying, that it is doing a lot. This is something that in global capitals won't be bought.
Indeed. We're going to leave it there for the moment. Anas Malik and Siddhant Sibal, thanks very much for joining us with those updates. On to a quick check on the latest regarding the Afghanistan peace talks. The U.S. Special Representative for Afghanistan, Zarmi Khalilzad, arrived in Islamabad earlier today. He is hoping to convince the Pakistani leadership to play a constructive role in the ongoing Afghanistan peace talks process. Khalilzad is expected to meet both the civilian and the military leadership in Pakistan and press upon the establishment to not play, quote-unquote, a spoiler. The deep state in Pakistan, as it's called, is involved in sponsoring and orchestrating terror attacks across the border. There is fear that this trend will derail the reconciliation process in Afghanistan. The visit comes just 2 days after intra-Afghan talks started in Qatar. The talks were off to a rocky start, though, as clashes broke out between the Taliban and the Afghanistan forces merely hours after the opening ceremony. The government has accused the Taliban of attacking its own convoy along a highway in Kunduz. In response, the security forces carried out airstrikes in the provinces of Baghlan and Jozlan. The government says the Taliban attacks have increased rather than decreasing since the talks were announced. Representatives from countries including India, the US, Turkey and Pakistan were also present at that opening ceremony. India's presence at the talks has not gone down well with Pakistan. Securing a ceasefire will be the civilian side's biggest goal as far as the talks are concerned, but the Taliban is yet to agree on this. The chief negotiator, Abdullah has hinted that the government could release more Taliban fighters in exchange for a ceasefire.
To be respected and cherished.